Good evening, everyone, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Welcome to TCS Live and our first ever Leaders Live Connect. We are super excited and I hope you are too. Today, we're joined by our global leader for digital and digital workspace, Mr. Krish Ashok. Now, Ashok and his team leveraged technology, design and behavioral science to design workplace solutions for the future. I'm sure many of you already follow him on Twitter or LinkedIn. And besides being a leader in digital, in his own words, he's a hobbyist. He's an avid musician, a food science enthusiast, a blogger, and much more. So I will not keep you waiting anymore. Let's bring in Ashok. Hi, Ashok. Welcome.
Hi, Tanvi. Thank you.
Okay, so Ashok, before we start off with our chat, tell me how's life and how's work, especially given the last 4 to 5 months.
It's been interesting. So I actually, even for this talk, I was just thinking, maybe should I wear something formal because it's a live event? And then I realized, no, actually, this is what work looks like, right? So I'm sitting in my home and as I've been for the last 4 months. More interestingly, we've been advising customers on how to really enable sort of work from home in a scalable way. So it's been interesting. I wouldn't say it's without its challenges. We've all been discovering new things. I mean, we're all used to separating, work from life. And now they're all together, right? So it's interesting times.
Yes, rightly said. It's extremely interesting times. A lot of us are trying a lot of new things, a lot of different things. So we're going to start off with our chat. So like I mentioned, Ashok, in your introduction, that you lead the Digital Workplace and Digital Workplace Reimagination Unit in TCS. Can you briefly tell our audience how you leverage digital to curate these workplace solutions?
So if you kind of think of the sort of history of the workplace itself, it kind of begins almost about 100 years ago is when we started having this phenomenon of you had factories and then you had offices. Right? Prior to that, you didn't have that, right? So you only had just factories for most part, or artisans and shops. The idea of an office where people would do knowledge work is about a 100-year-old phenomenon, right? So, and it started in the West, and it's sort of, that template is still the same. We all have these big offices. They're often either far away from the city or in the city. And we have cubicles and we have filing systems and so on. I think, a lot of the things that used to be analog in terms of, office mail trays where people would bring in mail, incoming, outgoing mail and so on, and typewriters, kind of, gave way to the first wave of technology in terms of, electronic typewriters and then computers and ultimately the internet. I think the single biggest change here has been the set of technologies that we broadly kind of classify as digital ever since 2007, which is mobile, big data, social media, for collaboration and so on. And in some sense, I think one, mobile smartphones basically enable people to work from anywhere. And a smartphone plus the cloud truly enable this, right? Because now your data can be accessible securely anywhere, wherever you are. And so in some sense, the improvement of what we call rich collaboration, right? So which is that collaboration that involves video, audio, like we are doing right now, right? This wasn't possible about say 5 or 10 years ago, this seamlessly. And in fact, it is this technology that is actually enabling work to happen right now as we speak. So if I really think about what digital workplace really is this idea of what kind of technology infrastructure combined with the kind of digital technologies and the digital sort of front ends with the right kind of collaboration behaviors and productive individual behaviors. This combination is really what we call digital workplace. So that in a nutshell is what it is.
Thanks, Ashok, for explaining it briefly. And like you rightly pointed out, it is more about the behavior or how we adopt to these technologies. So I was earlier listening to one of your podcasts and you mentioned carrying your office in your pocket during the pandemic. Now, of course, the pandemic has sort of pushed or, enabled this behavior of adapting to these technologies much faster than we would have otherwise. So where do you see this trend, going?
I think so. To be honest, I think remote work has been around for 10 years now, so it's not new. But remote work was always a distinctly sort of second tier way of working. the preferred way of working was always to come on time to an office and then work in person, collaborate with people face to face, and so on. So that was always the preferred way of working, right? So there's one thing that the pandemic has done is that it's just switched these priorities. Remote work is now the predominant way of working, and it will, beyond just the pandemic, it will become the predominant way of working for the foreseeable future, in the sense that you may have, unless you're in a healthcare industrial setting or any other setting where you really have to be in that work environment, I think that this is going to be the default way, at least for people working in technology. Remote work is going to be the default way of working, right? So I think it is, so in that sense, it's just a switch of what's called, you know, priorities in that sense. But I think what this does is that many of our work cultures, on the other hand, are based on the assumption that we're sitting in an office. Many things we take for granted. The fact that, hey, you can just, you know, reach over to somebody's desk and ask them for help, right? The fact that you can convene a meeting and quickly sort of whiteboard and, you know, think about ideas and so on, right? And more, you know, you can just have coffee with people at a cafeteria and kind of hear what other people are working on. So we call this ambient awareness. So the problem is that when you're working from home, you have none of this, right? Of course, there are other advantages. You save 2 to 3 hours on commuting, right? I think you save, yeah, I think it's good for the planet, definitely. And you also, your time is also not, you're in the office, you're working for 9 hours, right? But at home, you're continuously switching contexts, right? So, you know, I have to worry about whether the milk is going to spill, or I have to worry about whether my son is doing his homework. And so I think there's a, so this idea of working from home is more a cultural shift. And I think, to be honest, nobody knows exactly how to do this well. So we're all discovering as we speak. And I think over the next 1 or 2 years, I think the likes of TCS, who's been pioneering this at a large scale, given that we're saying, you know, 75% of people will mostly work from home for the foreseeable future, I think we will, more than anyone else, pioneer what these new optimal work from home behaviors are. And I think it's an interesting journey of discovery, if you will. So the other idea of having your office in your pocket is this, I think in some sense, this larger trend is what we call you are the office, right? The physical office is not the office. So whether you're at home, whether you're on the move or not, you have your devices, you have your secure data on the cloud, and you have applications that are available on these devices, made available on these devices. And yet there are two things. So the technology enables all of this quite easily, and that's great, right? But at the same time, the question that needs to be asked is this technology really well designed enough to address our work-life balances? Like, for example, there's nothing productive about getting notifications 200 times a day, right? If I'm, you know, there is nothing great about having a meeting at 6 a.m. in the morning over video conference and my last video conference at 10 p.m. at night. There's nothing remotely productive about this. So in some sense, I think the challenge for the next generation also is to take that thought leadership. And given that this is a generation of people who have grown up with technology far more than any other generation. So this is a generation that's been used to social media, used to video chatting, used to Snapchat, used to TikTok and the likes. And this is a generation that actually genuinely understands notions of privacy, work-life balance far better than the generation like mine, which is currently, you know, trying to implement these for customers. So I think, you know, my advice to everyone is to really say that, look, you really need to think about what is the right way to adopt these. And what is the right balance of productivity versus work-life balance versus ambient awareness, and what is good for mental health versus, you know, what is stressing and making you more anxious as you get more and more notifications and so on. I think we all have to discover what is the right way to do this together.
So got your point on that. Like you said, we are all learning, and probably we don't know what's the right way to do it, but it's all experience sharing that's going to come into picture. And you've also given a good advice to students that especially some of them would be stepping into the corporate world soon. So like you said, some of them would be more would slip into with greater ease than we've or the previous generation or our generations managing to do it. But the students also are dealing with this the same change, right? Because now classrooms have also become online. A lot of the teaching and learning is happening online. So on that front, of course, the shift is going to be simpler for them, but at the same time, it's going to be different. So what do you have to say about the teaching methodology, which will have to change or adapt to, you know, kind of prepare students to move into this new normal?
Absolutely. And in some sense, I think it's also, it is also my opinion, personal opinion that I think remote work is more productive than remote education in general. Okay. And I think there's some qualifications that I have to, some caveats here. So remote work is generally productive because you're generally, you kind of own your time. You're given a task. In the right kind of organization, I think the kind of culture that TCS wants to inculcate, you know, the supervisory and the managerial culture in remote work that we want to inculcate is not have someone looking over your shoulder and saying, what are you doing? Are you done? Are you done? And so on. But really just give you your time and space. It's very outcome driven. You finish your job, whether you learn something, you do it, then you play some music and get it done, or you really struggle hard, get it done in 20 hours or whatever it is entirely up to you, right? So I think that's one interesting thing that works in favor, at least in the technology industry when it comes to remote work. But on the other hand, when you think about education, right? At least I can see that, you know, my son is 8 years old. I don't think online schooling works up to at least high school, right? And I think high school students will have to really play a bigger role, and high school and college students, in kind of working with teachers and educators and colleges and universities in shaping the nature of online education. Because in my opinion, I don't think the people designing these systems get it, in that they think somehow just transferring that the physical online life of a rigid timetable directly online, that you have to sit in a, you know, class for these 1 hour or 2 hours or 3 hours, it doesn't work. I think people have to treat the remote medium fundamentally differently. We've been seeing some interesting ideas come from thought leaders like Salman Khan, not the actor, the Khan Academy, Salman Khan. Since he's been a pioneer in really getting people to learn remotely as well, right? A lot of remote learning does not happen in long periods of time. It happens in short spurts. And it does not happen by passive consumption of video content. It happens through interactivity, it happens through collaboration, it happens through social learning and so on. All of it naturally happen in a physical classroom, but you'll have to digitally introduce them into how they work. And the learning has to be multimodal. Multimodal in the sense that you can't just listen to a teacher drone on for hours. You should actually be watching that content on a crisp video format offline, and then using the teacher interaction primarily for problem solving, clearing doubts, and more advanced kind of topics, and not really just impartment of knowledge, right? So I think, you know, very few universities, I would even say that even the topmost universities are still figuring this out. I don't think anybody has the answers. Even the likes of Harvard and MIT are still figuring out how to do this. In fact, many of them have simply said, well, you know what, I think we'll probably postpone some of these things till, you know, when the pandemic is over and so on. So it is an interesting dilemma. But again, my message again is that you guys will have a better idea of this than your teachers when it comes to what's working in the sense of remote education. And given that for at least the next, you know, 18 months or so, there's going to be a good chunk of this that's going to happen remotely. So the way for you to learn more effectively has to be, you have to divide your time into, when is it that I'm consuming content and learning stuff? Then I take a break, then I solve a problem. Then I go live with my friends and, you know, sort of exchange doubts and, you know, do things together. And then obviously the most premium time is when I actually get live time with a teacher, when I'm able to say, perhaps ask doubts and clarify some of the more complex things and questions that I have. So in the sense that I think people have to think differently about what are the kinds of things that I'm best, I'd rather just do by myself, rather than simply sit in front of a video chat with, you know, 100 people, versus when is that video experience really, really effective and truly effective for me. And I think people really have to design that. And I think universities and colleges that kind of crack this, and schools that crack this, you will see that they will start to do better over the future, because I think a ton of this will also continue. Although in my experience, unlike work, I think education will at the first opportunity try and switch back to an in-person mode. But I think the exposure to digital technologies will change the nature of how that in-person education works in the future. Because people will now realize what is useful when I'm learning remotely versus what's not working. And the things that work when you're learning remotely will need to be transferred into the world where you go back to your universities and you're actually in person and so.
I think that was really well put. Your point on the fact that universities or education institutes may switch back to a traditional mode of learning, but you will find a gap that, you know, while I was learning online, this was happening for me, this was working for me. I was organizing myself in a ABC pattern, which is not feasible. And then we'll have to look at a more hybrid sort of a model, definitely. So Ashok, you, somebody who is an engineer, but you've also, I mentioned in my introduction that you're a hobbyist, you're a serial hobbyist, you love playing a lot of instruments, you have your own blog, you've been a radio jockey, in fact, in the past, if I'm not wrong. So I just also noticed that this was also a question which has been posted by one of the students, that how do you manage to, you know, imbibe or mix the arts and the sciences and the engineering, everything together?
So I think, you know, the usual anecdote that I often give to people who ask me this question, I get asked this question quite often, how do you find the time? So the one hand, obviously, there is, one has to recognize that, yes, you know, as somebody who's been in TCS for 21 years now, as someone who is 43 years old, obviously, one is that you have to think about time management in a fundamentally different way. And at the same time, you know, I think you'll also have that sort of privilege to be able to perhaps buy devices and gadgets that save you time and so on. So I have to recognize that privilege. But at the same time, I want to start with this interesting anecdote, right? There was this researcher from New York University who once asked a question at a TED Talk about, how long, and this was obviously in the context of the US, but you can apply the same thing to India, just multiply by three, because our population is about 3 to 4 times more, right? So how long do you think it took people to put together Wikipedia, right? So if Wikipedia was a project, IT project, and you needed millions of people to all write articles together, if you put a project plan, how many person hours of effort was Wikipedia, right? The estimate that these scientists came up with was that it was a 100 million person hour project, that it took 100 million hours of time. Could be millions of people, each one putting maybe 5 minutes or so, it doesn't matter, right? So it's 100 million person hours, right? Is how long it took to write the millions of articles on Wikipedia, right? Now, then they asked a question about how much time do people in the US spend watching just advertisements on TV only during prime time every day in a year? Right? Only just during prime time, so not in a year, in a day. How much time do they spend? The answer is apparently 3 billion hours.
Wow.
Right? So that's the amount of time people just spend staring at TV content or some kind. Right? In this context, it was advertisements. Even in the day, in the age of streaming, it could be anything. Any kind of passive content consumption, entertainment consumption, you can still see. Just advertisements, right? This is not just even the useful stuff. Just the advertisement, commercial advertisement content is 3 billion hours. And he says that if you just translate that to this 100 billion, it essentially means that if people stopped watching advertisements for one day, right, you could put together some, you know, 20 or 30 Wikipedias. There is that much time left. So in some sense, I think the larger message is that we sometimes, and as particularly young people, and I tell you, you realize this as you grow forward, when you're young, time will seem to move slowly, and that you'll feel like, you know, why is time moving slowly, right? Time tends to move faster because you kind of value time more as you grow older, right? So it's just a very human thing, right? So, but I think the interesting thing here is that if you can think differently about your time, if you split your time into what is time that you do in getting your job done, right? What is time that you spend in learning so that you can do your job better? The third category of time is, what are things that you do that will generally make you a better informed, a more employable kind of person, general knowledge sort of thing. And a fourth kind of time, which is things that you need to do simply because it's good for your mental health and so on, right? And by the way, this is, I'm not even accounting for the fact that you have to wash your clothes, you have to learn to cook, you have to do all these. Those are absolute necessity. Let's subtract all of that. Okay? I don't think cooking is a special skill. Cooking is an absolute basic skill. Everybody needs to have it, right? I think we all end up, at least all the men, Indian men particularly, are terrible in that they assume that their mothers will cook for them till they're 21 and their wives will cook for them for the rest of their life. And I think it's a terrible attitude that we all have to fix. Leave all that aside, right? So you take these four kinds of time. It's important you think about how, as an engineer, you optimize these. So one is that the time that you need to do your work, strangely enough, it is your job to minimize. Why? Because you're an engineer. And as an engineer, you must strive to create shortcuts. You must strive to automate. You must strive to pick up skills and any other mechanisms that you have to do the work that you are given in as lesser time as possible with as high quality as possible, right? So because you know, you do it in a haphazard way in a short amount of time, then you'll end up having to do rework anyway. So let's, you know, so that's the first thing. So you have to be able to reduce the amount of time that you spend on actually doing your core job so that you free up time to pick up skills that will help you actually do this faster. So one is obviously continuous learning is definitely that you need to. And by the way, you need to, you in a sense that in a week, if somebody asks you how many hours in a week did you work? People have a sense, because I filled my timesheet, I know I work, you know, 45 hours a week or whatever it is, right? 54, 55 hours a week. But if people ask you how much time you spent learning, people don't have an idea, right? You should. It's actually more important than the time that you spend working. So you should have a measure and you should know how much time you're spending learning for it. In equal measure, you should also know how much time you're spending on doing other things that overall improve your employability in terms of picking additional skills, not directly related to what you're doing, but other digital skills. If you know, if you're a core, say a database administrator, can I pick up cloud and big data? If I'm a core, you know, insurance business guy, can I pick up, say, artificial intelligence? And so on. There's just so much learning content available, right? So you've got to be able to continuously pick up new skills all the time. And the last one is the fact that we, as a human species, we are made for balancing both grunt work as well as artistic work, right? So it is important that you don't forget art, right? So I think unfortunately the Indian, you know, system of both education and the way our parenting goes is that in class 10 is when we'll probably say, oh, you please give up all your arts now, focus only on exams, focus only on all of this. And I think it's a tragedy, right? You know, India, for the size of its population, is one of the least creative per capita, because we get our creativity beaten out of us by class 10. Now, you know, of course it's improving, because you see all these startups coming in, all these other new companies now growing. It's primarily because it's a new generation of kids who've now been given that opportunity to also pursue their creativity and so on. So never give up your hobbies, because I'll tell you what you do in your work does not make you creative. What you learn to do your work does not make you creative, and all these other things. What you do as an artist is what makes you creative, in a way that you can then apply that creativity in your work, right? So it's sitting and, you know, composing music and learning an instrument, learning a language, you know, doing sketching, doing art, etc. Exercises parts of your brain that then you then take that break and you come back and you apply it on your work problem, you'll actually be, you'll find yourself doing much better, right? So in that sense, I think, you know, that is really why I think you'll have to think about how you divide your time appropriately, and then you'll find that you have tons of time to do this.
Again, wonderfully spoken, and I think what my main takeaway is that everybody should learn how to cook, especially the men. So I hope all these boys were listening. But of course, he gave some really good advice, and he gave those pointers on, you know, make sure you know how much time you're dedicating to learning, make sure you're learning continuously. So, and of course, like he said, you know, your creative side or your investment in your arts will also eventually help and, you know, bring you some returns on your work front as well. So I hope you guys made a good note of that. Now, as I spoken earlier, we'd asked our student audience to post questions that they may have, and, you know, you'd be happy to answer them. So I'm going to take on the questions now. Sure. So the first question is, what about core engineering sectors? How is the workplace changing or will change there?
It very well will. So a couple of things. So there have been some changes in engineering independent of the pandemic. The pandemic just accelerated some of these changes, right? So if I take core engineering, so let's say if you're working in an oil rig, for instance, right? So there is obviously now with technology, one of the things that will happen in most places where you have to work in a hazardous or an industrial environment, are going to get either they're going to be automated with robots to as much extent as possible. So I think the kinds of jobs, that engineering jobs that will need to be there are people who can actually implement or manage or supervise those robots in some sense, right? So this has already been happening, but it'll just get tremendously accelerated, right? So, you know, you compare, say, a car factory that makes, say, cars in India versus, say, a Tesla factory. The number of employees for every car they produce is very small, in that the ton of the stuff is actually done by robotics, right? And at the same time, we also learned that using robots to do cars entirely has its own problems that requires human supervision and so on. So I think in some sense, I think the way I see it is that the role of pure play engineering in industry will change to a very interdisciplinary mix of, while understanding the core engineering, the ability to understand the human elements, the ability to understand automation, the ability to understand the interface between automation and human beings, I think will become the kind of skill that will be important. And more importantly, the one thing that will happen now is the ability to do all of this remotely. So it's already happening, right? So earlier, deep sea guys who had to go down to explore oil and all that had to go in a very dangerous submersible and all that. Now they just send drones, they send robots. Right. And some, you know, they actually hire people who are good at PlayStation to sit in Houston or wherever it is and control those things, you know, that are, you know, off the coast of Australia. Right. So I think those, you have to think of it in terms of the fact that literally every job that you can think of, automation will play and robotics will play a significant role in the next 10 years. And because of the pandemic, it's going to get accelerated. That's the only thing. Right. It was already happening, except that it's going to get accelerated. So that's the lens through which you have to see. In some industries, it may happen slower and some it may happen fast. That's about it.
So it's just about time and how soon or late any industry adapts to that. Great. Moving on to the next question is the change in work or job shaping the future of workplace, or technology is changing the work or the job that we do and hence the workplace is changing? So it's like a chicken and an egg story.
It's almost always a bit of both. So technology-led disruption has always happened. I think so the invention of the telephone actually changed the nature of offices far more than the other way around, right? It's not like companies were there and then they somehow drove the invention of the telephone and incrementally improved it. Telephone just came and just, you know, disrupted the idea that you could now have offices anywhere and they could all remotely connect with each other, versus when you literally had to send like horses, messages on horses, or use a combination of telegram and obviously telephone and so on, right? So likewise, I think computing did the same thing, right? Computing just one shot changed the fact that you can now sit and analyze data, you can store data, you don't have to do it in paper, and then you can detect patterns in data. And so obviously just changed the nature of businesses and the workplace in one shot, created new roles for people and so on. The internet did the same thing. Mobile phones did the same thing. So on the one hand, there is always going to be disruptive technology-led changes in the workplace. But I think what will happen is that, but over a longer period of time, as workplaces then eventually learn to embrace that technology and embrace that change, they will then start driving incremental changes in how we react to other changes and other technologies, and less disruptive technologies or less disruptive changes, if you will, over a longer period of time. Only distinction is that the period of time over which change happens has also been going down, right? It used to take 10, 50 years, 50 years sometimes in the 1800s, took 10 years in the computing era, now takes months and weeks. So the time period is crunched, but it's always a bit of both. Disruptive technology will sort of run into resistance from existing ways of working, existing sources of revenue and so on. And then it reaches a point of efficiencies where, you know, this existing thing cannot prevent it anymore. So, you know, it just completely bulldozes over it and, you know, goes over, right? So, you know, in 2007, nobody expected the iPhone to succeed, but it succeeded only because it crossed a certain threshold of what a smartphone could do. It wasn't the first smartphone. Nokia had tons of smartphones, but they were all terrible smartphones. They were really expensive and they didn't do half the things that ultimately it all came together, right? So it's not like Apple is some great, innovator that invented, many things that went into a smartphone. They did not. They took advantage of the fact that Toshiba miniaturized storage and hard disks. without which the iPod or the iPhone would not have been possible. So it was Toshiba's invention of really miniaturizing that. So once it reached that size threshold, that's when Steve Jobs said, this is a size and weight I can live with, right? Likewise, the global positioning system satellites and the ability to get maps and so on. Likewise, again, the invention of the LED and the touchscreen, capacitive touchscreens, because resistive touchscreens are terrible, right? So it's, and Apple didn't invent any of these three things, okay? But they put it together first, right? So in many cases, always disruptive innovation is often less about actually inventing something new versus actually combining all the things that are just about mature and releasing something quicker to market than others, right? So in that sense, I think, you know, it's always going to be technology led, but then there'll be a ton of changes that will come from actual workplaces embracing those changes, businesses and business models that evolve, and that happen at their own pace, and then their impact on how our people work and so on.
Great. So moving on to the next question, which is more from a job point of view. The future of work is changing, and a good extent of learning and teaching has also changed. So what should students do to be more job ready when we don't have in-person internships or projects like how they did earlier?
Now, I think the internet offers a spectacular range of learning content, learning opportunities, for you to be job ready, actually, right? So if you ask me, it's not just about internships, which is fine. Internships definitely nice, good, but not everyone can get an internship and so on. But nothing stops you from, say, picking up Python skills and then going and signing up for a Project Euler challenge and doing those problems in increasing order of difficulty, right? In many, in fact, if you walk into an interview at TCS and tell the guy that I'm actually level 77 in Project Euler, people will say, that's very impressive, right? And likewise, you could do Kaggle challenges, take up big data challenges, AI challenges from Kaggle and learn it. So the whole idea is to not just learn new things, but apply them. And I would say the really, you know, go-to technologies are big data, AI, and modern application development, which is modern web, modern API-driven development, would be the go-to skills from a IT standpoint going forward in the future, right? It'll make you universally, if you understand cloud, DevOps, full stack development, combination of big data, AI, and you know, some kind of fourth generation, you know, programming language, if you will. I think, and more often than not, your ability to use existing capabilities, libraries, open source, rather than simply write everything from scratch. Let me tell you, nobody writes anything from scratch in IT anymore, right? You always start by assembling stuff together. And I think that is, and more, rather than just learning it and, you know, take some problems and put some skin in the game, sign up for a Kaggle challenge, sign up for a Project Euler challenge and so on. A ton of these things, you know, take up freelance work, you know, build websites for your family and all of that. So there are a ton of things that you can do, I think, to make yourself relevant in the world that we know.
So not only self-learn, but also apply on your own. And, you know, that should keep that should get you covered. The next question is from Guru. And he says that I'm a final year BE student and a beginner to programming, in addition to learning technical hacking. But I don't see that campus encourages that so much. So is it really worth for him to learn ethical hacking? And how should he improve in that field?
So white hat ethical hacking, or white hat hacking, as we call it, as opposed to black hat hacking, which is to hack for nefarious purposes, to actually steal data and so on, is a very interesting area, right? So, but there's also a very fine line between what is ethical hacking and what is unethical hacking. And often what happens is that at your age, what you think is ethical may not be considered ethical by someone else, right? So I think often that is the single challenge, right? The way I would really think about it is to rather look at cybersecurity patterns, such as, you know, how phishing attacks happen, how, you know, SQL injection attacks happen, right? How your servers can be hardened, right? These are all, this is standard knowledge, right? And if you internalize those practices in terms of how do I make sure that if I run a server, my web server, it is hard to penetrate, right? So it is hardened, and I know all the things from a basic Linux system administration standpoint, from an encryption and keys standpoint, from the standpoint of also my applications, and the fact that the JavaScript and all the rest of the stuff that I write also does not allow data to be leaked and so on, and that I don't have plain text passwords being passed around and so on. As I said, there are a ton of patterns that I think you can all internalize without necessarily attempting to go after someone's system and say, hey, look, I hacked your system. Now give me, you know, recognition and so on. So that's always a very hazy line. And I would typically urge only people who are phenomenally advanced, that have a fair amount of experience and potentially access to lawyers, to go after that kind of ethical hacking in a performative ethical hacking. Right? You can still learn to be an ethical hacker by picking up all these skills and just fine tuning them, right? Instead of, and if necessary, yeah, if you find harmless, you know, you find some company's website, maybe some Tata Group company's website having some weakness, etc. Yeah, by all means, write to their administrator and say that, look, you have a problem, right? I think that is fine. But I think it's a hazy line, you know, I wouldn't suggest try it on a bank or try it in any place where I think there's sensitive data, there's money involved, there's personally identifiable information involved. I would stay away from that till you actually get certified, till you actually are working in a formal cybersecurity capacity before you do that.
Okay. So, Guru, I hope you've got the answer to your question. There are a few more which are on technology and internship, which I think you've answered in parts about, you know, I know C and C++. Is that good enough for me to sit for a campus for a product-based or a service-based company? I think Ashok already mentioned. Okay,
no, I think you'll need. So as I said, I think you'll need. It's great. I think C or C++ is great if you're actually writing device drivers, writing video compression stuff for, you know, encryption related. More at the operating system, at the lower levels, the innards of the system, and so on. Right. So, or writing code for sensors and so on. But I would say that's absolutely great. I think it really gets you fundamentals in a very powerful way. I mean, I grew up learning C++, so, and I think it tremendously helped me by the time I was writing Ruby on Rails or Python or something like that, right? So the way I would see is that you should always learn a script-based language like a Python or a Ruby on Rails or JavaScript, which I kind of makes it easier to write common day utility stuff, right? Theoretically, yes, you can do big data and AI using C and C++. Could be quite a pain. Much easier to do it on Python. Much easier to use those libraries, TensorFlow, and just quickly, you know, create some models. Much, much easier, right? So I would say that just simply C, C++ is okay if you're only forcing a carrier writing device drivers, sensor-related code, you know, code for 5G radios and so on. If not, I would urge you to think about a Python or a one higher level, at least at a Java or higher kind of language as well.
Thanks, Ashok. I hope you've got your answer, Vinayak. So thank you. This has been a wonderful chat. I think we've managed to answer most of the questions. There are a few which will repeat. So, you know, you can refer back to the video which we're going to be publishing on our portal. So, you know, you to the chat with Ashok and pick your points from there. But thanks,
there was
Ashok.
One question
this has been wonderful.
Like, so there was one last question I think I would like to answer, which is about advantages to joining a product company versus a services company, right? So it's just that, you know, you join where you think your career aspirations are. So that's the most important thing, right? But I think at your age, what information you may not know about the nature of the industry is the fact that, having been in this industry for 20 years, what I can tell you is that more than 80% of all IT needs of Fortune 1000 companies, the largest companies in the world, 80% of their IT needs require custom-built solutions, require services, require bespoke solutions, require significant customizations and extensions of existing products, which the product companies themselves will not do. But yes, because of the nature and the glamour of building a very large popular product and so on, there's a certain non-linear side to that, attractiveness to that. But bear in mind that inherently, all the IT needs of the world cannot be met by products. It's just not possible, because companies are too unique, their problems are too individual, and they all require custom-built solutions. And that's the reason why TCS is a $22 billion company, right? So clearly because that demand exists, right? And I think it's an entirely different challenge as opposed to the challenges that you face when you build a product. When you build a product, you're trying to build one bare minimum that applies to as many people as possible, versus IT, where your job is to build the solve the exact 100% of the problem that every one of your customers has. So I think these are just entirely different worlds. So it's important that you know. And so in one sense, regardless of which one you choose, I think it's possible to find a very fulfilling career in either one of them. So that's what I would say.
Great. So I hope they heard you loud and clear. So it's about where your interest lies, and there's nothing like he mentioned. I think he explained it beautifully when he said that, you know, the reason we are such a large company is because there are people out there, there are Fortune 500 companies and others who need services like us. So thank you, Ashok. Thank you for sharing your experience, your art, your advice and technology expertise. It's been a wonderful chat. I'm sure the students would agree. And yeah, we hope to connect with you soon again.
Thanks, everyone. Bye. Bye-bye. Great. Thanks.